Well, thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to be here. Like many of the other speakers, I've been coming here for a couple of decades at least. The condensed matter activity at ICTP is a bit younger than the other fields, but also thriving very much. And in the early days, Professor Yu Liu led a real thriving effort in condensed matter, and that's continuing today. So let me just turn to my talk then. That's the title of my talk, and I'm going to give you an introduction to many problems in condensed matter physics, motivated largely by experiments, on the dynamics of systems in which some of the central paradigms of condensed matter physics fail. Okay, so let me just review what the summarize conventional condensed matter physics in a couple of slides. So the basic principles are twofold. First, you want to understand the ground state of a many-body quantum system, but you build it up by simply taking the product of single particle states. So in a metal, you determine the band structure of a single electron in the periodic potential, and you just fill up the lowest energy state, and that gives you a trial wave function for the many-body ground state. Now, by itself, it's not very sophisticated, but the sophisticated idea is that you can adiabatically continue without encountering any singularities to the true ground state from this simple product state. So that's been a very successful paradigm and behind almost everything in the condensed matter textbooks with a few small variations. The other central idea is the idea of quasi-particles, and this describes the excitation to the system. So in a metal, you could take an electron from underneath the Fermi level to above the Fermi level, and now you have created here an electron and a hole. And the idea is that as long as you're not too far from the Fermi level, these excitations essentially move freely, like free particles. Of course, they have all kinds of renormalizations from the interactions. Their effective mass is not the mass of a free electron. But if I looked at the long-time dynamics of the system at finite temperature, it would be an excellent approximation to describe it in terms of a Boltzmann distribution function for the quasi-particles and the quasi-holes. Okay, what I want to do today is really uproot both of these central principles. So if I uproot the first principles, I can talk about many particle states that are disconnected from the product state. Today we would say such states have some form of long-range quantum entanglement. And the most famous example is really the fractional quantum Hall effect, which many speakers have mentioned, which has many beautiful properties. But it does retain the idea of a quasi-particle. Of course, the quasi-particles in the fractional quantum Hall effect are not electrons. They're some emergent particles with exotic charges. But if I wanted to think about the dynamics of a quantum Hall system, I can think of it one by one in terms of a small density of these quasi-particle excitations. So really, that's much of the references to condensed matter in this conference, and I think also in the next talk, will be for systems where there are quasi-particles. So I want to really uproot that principle too and talk about systems without quasi-particles, which are also disconnected from the single particle state. So this seems like a very radical thing to do, and in fact, theoretically, there's only a few examples, in a sense, where this is true. But experimentally, especially in the last 20 years, we found many metals, I'll show some of the pictures later on, where this seems to be really the first thing that we have to understand, the general dynamic of the system without quasi-particles. So the basic examples, apart from a few bells and whistles, are just these two, and I'll talk about both if time permits. The first one are conformal field theories, familiar to string theorists in very different contexts. And I'm going to restrict myself to dimension d greater than 1, because d equals 1 are special in many cases, and for the particular properties I'll focus on, they're actually quite simple. And then the experimentally far more important case is the case of systems without any conformal or relativistic symmetry. These are generally metals, but not of the Boltzmann-Landau variety, but metals without, as far as we can tell, any quasi-particle description. And theoretically, the best examples of this today are also in spatial dimension d equals 2. So this is the outline of my somewhat ambitious outline of my talk, but let me just begin then with conformal field theories. This is work with these three collaborators. So here's one of the primary motivations for looking at such systems, the system of ultra-cold atoms in a periodic potential. And as you vary the depth of the potential, there's a phase transition from an insulating state where the bosons, the bosonic atoms hardly move, to one where they move freely without resistance in a superfluid. So then as a function of some parameter in the Hamiltonian, you have two phases, the superfluid and the insulator, and you can describe that in terms of a broken symmetry, very much like the Higgs field in Professor Kibble's talk yesterday, except that this is not coupled to any gauge field. Electromagnetism is presumed to be, actually in this case, the boson, the neutral. So there's a U1 order parameter, a complex number, whose condensate identifies a superfluid, and then there's an insulator when the potential well is deep enough. Now we also know, and again for the lack of time I won't give any of the evidence, that in the vicinity of this quantum critical point, the long distance physics are described by a quantum field theory. And it's a very familiar quantum field theory to particle physicists. It's just the lambda psi Ford field theory with a tuning parameter lambda minus lambda c here, which is really changing, going from positive mass to negative mass, and some self-repulsive self-interaction between the bosons. And it's important for everything I say that this is in 2+1 space-time dimensions. So what's known about this theory is that in 2+1 dimensions, this coupling U, in a sense, reaches a fixed point value, and there's a universal low energy limit, which is described by the O2-Wilson-Fisher fixed point. And that's one of the prime examples of a conformal field theories realizable in experiments in 2+1 space-time dimensions. So this, at this point, we know that there are no quasi-particles. In other words, if I perturb the system in any way, I won't see tracks of particles or holes running in different directions. I'll see some rather complicated lump of excitations decaying slowly in some manner in all directions, and I'd like to be able to describe how that time evolution proceeds. So this is the zero temperature phase diagram, so let me turn on a finite temperature, and then the two ground state phases go into these blue regions where, in fact, there is a quasi-particle description. Very much here, it's pretty much the Boltzmann theory, and here it's a version of what you'd call a Boltzmann theory involving the number of Goldstone modes and vortices. But my interest here is exclusively in the central region, quantum critical, where we really need a description without quasi-particles in 2+1 dimensions. Okay, so over the past more than a decade, many different attempts have been tried, even for this very basic problem, to come up with a quantitatively accurate description of what's going on in here for a very simple property like the conductivity. So you just imagine, say, tilting this potential with a field, a force, and then asking how do the bosons move, with what resistance do they move in this region. So I'll begin this by just describing very quickly the results of the Boltzmann dynamics. And the reason we applied this first was really because that's the only thing we knew. And the way we're going to do that is really take the Boltzmann description of the insulator and just somehow, as best as we can, extrapolate it to a region where it has no right to exist. Formally, the way you do that, so here's a review of what Boltzmann taught us, how condensed matter theory should proceed. If you're given a many-body quantum system, these are the steps you take. You first identify the quasi-particles, then you compute their scattering matrix elements, assuming you can overcome all the difficulties Nima mentioned, in this case you can, and say you know all of these numbers. But you want to now describe some finite temperature non-equilibrium properties at long time involving these basic excitations. Well, if the quasi-particles are dilute enough or well-defined, then Boltzmann has taught us how to do that. And that's take all this information, which you can view as the short-time information, and put it into a quantum Boltzmann equation, which is a somewhat ad hoc resummation, but you know, from practice, known to work extremely well. And then this can give you dissipative properties at frequencies much smaller than the quasi-particle collision rate. The basic short-time properties would be apply at times shorter than the quasi-particle collision time. Okay, so if you apply this algorithm, and I'm jumping ahead here, the way you do that is you take your field theory, which had one complex number, and generalizes to a to n real numbers. So that theory has an O(n) symmetry. And in the large n limit, quasi-particles are approximately defined. So in that theory, if you compute the conductivity, among the things you find is that it's a universal number in units of the quantum unit of conductance. And at high frequencies, which is in some sense the short time part, it's given by a pure number which you can compute quite accurately in a 1/n expansion or many other methods. This is the analog of the level number of a Kac-Moody algebra in 1 plus 1 dimension. On the other hand, at low frequencies, you have this very sharp peak which becomes taller and thinner as n goes to infinity, and that's the only limit in which the theory applies. And that, if you wish, is a remnant of the quasi-particle, because the theory began with quasi-particles where it doesn't really exist for small n. So at this point, we're not sure how quantitatively accurate this result would be. Okay, so now let me go to an entirely different way of thinking about the same problem, exactly the same quantity I want to compute, but I'm going to use a completely different set of tools. And the whole point is here, this gives us an example where we know how we are beginning to understand how to ask such questions in systems that don't have quasi-particles. So we never assume quasi-particles. And instead of this four-step recipe I described earlier, I do the following. So I start with some CFT. Now, CFTs don't have quasi-particles, but they have somewhat analogous thing you would call primary operators. And I can't describe what happens when you scatter two particles, but I can. There's an analogous quantity called the operator product expansion, which tells you what happens when you make two operators close to each other. So you can use that information, and I'm jumping ahead with some analysis that took us several years to carry out carefully, and deduce then the frequency dependence of the conductivity that I'm describing. Well, this process only works at high frequencies, at frequencies omega bigger than temperature. I have set h bar and kb to 1 now. And all of these numbers, sigma infinity we already met, b1 and b2, are somehow related to the structure of the conformal field theory. In this case, b1 depends on a certain scalar operator which has dimension 3 minus 1 over nu, where nu is the correlation length exponent, which is known exceedingly accurately. And b2 depends on the OPE between two O2 currents and the energy momentum tensor, which you can compute in a 1/n expansion. Anyway, so that's the kind of information you get just by using conformal description. So very recently, Eric Sorensen has simulated this boson model, or a version of it which is easy to put on the computer. But by construction, that whole process can only be done in Euclidean time at finite temperature, which means the frequencies are just integer multiples of 2 pi t. And from this simulation, he can then get a conductivity which depends only on this integer. That is a highly non-trivial result in this lattice model. It's a careful check of the lattice regularization, and for different regularization, you get the same function as a function of this integer n. And this curve here, the blue curve, is a fit to the operator product expansion and allows us, and the fit works beautifully with exactly the right value of nu, and gives you then, in principle, information on B1 and B2 that you can make as precise as you want, depending on how hard you want to bother your computer simulation friends. On the other hand, all this information, it's still not precise enough to go from Euclidean time and large frequencies to Minkowski frequencies at small and Minkowski time and small frequencies. And this is again related to very much the problem that Michael Berry talked about yesterday. It's the Stokes phenomenon. You're analytically continuing a function that's defined only on integers, and you want to go in the complex plane and get it at very low frequencies. And any kind of polynomial fitting to this is just very ill-defined. It doesn't work with any degree of reliability. So what do we do? So that's sort of where we are, where we can very reliably turn the crank and check everything we've done from numerical studies. And there are no way of doing the numerical studies in real time. Then you have the sign problem and other difficulties. So what I'm going to do here is things that we've learned from string theorists, which apply in a controlled manner to certain conformal field theories, which are made up of gauge fields in the and matrices. We certainly don't have anything here, but what we're going to do is try to use that general structure to attack this very difficult problem of extrapolating from high frequencies to low frequencies. So what string theories have taught us, that every conformal field theory is dual to some gravitational theory in anti-de Sitter space, with this is the metric of anti-de Sitter space. I'm only showing the spatial directions, and there's an emergent spatial direction R, and time is not shown. So my conformal field theory is sitting on the boundary here. Now, I know a lot about this conformal field theory. I know its operator product expansion and some of its correlation functions. So you can, in fact, map all of that information into a theory of gravity. And it turns out you need what I'm calling the Einstein-Maxwell-Weyl scalar theory. You need a Maxwell term because the gauge field is dual to the conserved U1 current. You need Weyl, you need this term to properly get the OPE of the currents and the stress and energy momentum tensor. And then you need the scalar field because there was this relevant scalar perturbation with dimension 3 minus 1 over nu. And this is the minimal theory, then that will match the OPE. Now, of course, if I really took a gravitational dual of this Wilson-Fisher theory, it's probably a much more complicated object. And the idea is here, I've somehow integrated out all those effects, truncated it without any formal justification, and matched now all the couplings here to the OPE that I know. Okay, so that's formally not under control, but optimistically you can say, you know, neither was the epsilon expansion of Wilson and Fisher, where he fearlessly applied it at epsilon equals 1. Okay, so we're just going to try this procedure and see how well it works. So I've done this step. So the last step is really the most interesting and physical step of this process, which then relates these dissipative processes that I've been discussing in the Boltzmann equation to properties of a horizon of a black hole. So at finite temperature, then if you take a conformal field theory to finite temperature, then you get a horizon of a black brain at the Hawking temperature T, which is the same as the temperature of the conformal field theory. And then various dissipative processes of the conformal field theory get mapped onto dissipative properties on the horizon of the black brain. So anyway, so this is the recipe that we apply to then compute or extrapolate the known information of this conformal field theory to low frequencies. And to summarize the whole, everything I've said so far, in a sense, it's the Boltzmann equation, which did the extrapolation of a quasi-particle system, is being replaced by Einstein's equation at the horizon of a black brain, at a black brain. So if I took the simplest Einstein-Maxwell theory, which is what we did many years ago, you get a very boring result, just a constant independent of frequency and temperature. But when you put in the additional term and all the OPEs that I've discussed, this is then our final result. So this is a combination of quantum Monte Carlo results, our understanding of the structure of the OPE, extrapolated via the minimal gravitational theory to low frequencies. So there is a result, and it gives us some very precise quantitative numerical information. This scale is fully determined. There's no adjustable parameters, as is that one. And we'd like to check it or compare it with something. Unfortunately, we can't, because there is no other theoretical tool for determining this function. And perhaps someday there will be experiments. Then there'll be a check of these extrapolation methods using holography. All right, so I think I'm doing okay on time. So then let me go on to the second part, where I'm going to move beyond conformal field theories, which apply really to a very restricted set of systems in condensed matter physics, and think about a more general set of systems. So here, this is work with a different group of people, and I'm going to focus on some ideas that are related to the physics of the high-temperature superconductors. So these materials are made up of planes of copper and oxygen in which electrons are hopping around. And as you change the density of the electrons, you get a very complicated phase diagram. And in 5 minutes, I'm not going to be able to summarize the 20 years of experimental work that have gone on in try to understand what's going on in this phase diagram. So, but the regime of most interest to me is this strange metal, where experiments show that the resistance is approximately linear in temperature over a very wide temperature range, right near the optimal doping point with the highest critical temperature. And very recently, I've been involved with some rather exciting work, to me anyway, with the scanning tunneling microscopy group of Seamus Davis, where we think we've understood in great detail what's going on in here. And, you know, again, that's a long and also very interesting story, in my opinion, but I'm not going to say it. What I want to focus on is this endpoint where this exotic auto parameter seems to disappear. And there's a lot of indication in many experiments that there is some dramatic change in the ground state within the superconductor. And we want to now relate this quantum critical point to a strange metal. Okay, so what I'm just going to jump ahead and give you our proposal. This is actually, some of this is not even published, although some has. And so by no means established, but it gives you a flavor of the kind of theories that many condensed matter physicists are using to describe the strange metal. So you start with electrons with spin up and down, and you also have a system with magnetic correlations. So you introduce a matrix R, which tells you something about the local orientation of the magnetism. And then you write your electrons in a rotating reference frame, if you wish, in terms of some more basic fermions I'll call psi. Now, when you do this, you immediately introduce an SU2 gauge redundancy, because you can multiply R and psi by an arbitrary SU2 matrix. And so the theory for these new emergent particles then will be an SU2 gauge theory. So jumping ahead many steps, let me just summarize in a particle physics language what you get at the end. So you can get, you can imagine now a following theory. But first of all, you have these fermion psi that carry the SU2 gauge charges. So they move in some band structure and dispersion and Fermi surfaces that I'm not going to describe. But they don't carry the physical spin of the electron. They just carry some SU2 gauge index. Then there will also be an emergent SU2 gauge boson. And then there turns out, when you look at the microscopic structure of what's going on, there's also a Higgs field, which carries SU2 adjoint charge. So when this Higgs field condenses, the gauge symmetry is broken down from SU2 to U1. So as you'll see, all these numbers are very suggestive and appropriate for this building. There's no, there's in fact even a cross U1 if I put in the electric charge. But anyway, so, and the reason this happens is because there's a reconstruction of the Fermi surface. So anyway, from with this information and these gauge charges, you can write down a Lagrangian, which I won't write down, but it's very much like what you do in particle physics, with the crucial difference that these fermions have a complicated band structure and are not Dirac fermions. They have a Fermi surface which separates the empty from the occupied states. So to summarize then, what I want to focus on in the remainder of my talk, which is 5 minutes, is this critical point where the SU2 gauge breaks down to U1 in the presence of fermions. Now that's something, of course, what you do in the theory of weak interaction. But the big difference is that the fermions here carry a chemical potential. They carry a Fermi surface. So what this means is that when you go to the Higgs phase, the fermions don't acquire a mass, as in the standard model, but the Fermi surface reconstructs. And this is a phase transition that doesn't have any broken symmetry, because there's no gauge invariant auto parameter that you can write down. So now theories of this type have been studied a great deal over the past 10 years in condensed matter physics, you know, many things have been understood, but they've resisted for reasons I think not fully understood, complete analysis of transport properties. And at least in my own case, I think my understanding and the proposals we have made hold very much to lessons we learned from holography. So here we're not even going to try to take a model which is exactly this field theory. We're just going to take a model of a non-Fermi liquid and try to extract some general lessons. So that's where it is. So I'm going to go very quickly now. I'm happy to discuss more later with anyone who's interested. So with the CFT, this is a picture of a CFT, some relativistic fermions coupled to gauge fields. That's equivalent to ADS4. So now when you turn a chemical potential, you get a Fermi surface. And in the gravitational theory, that corresponds to having some electric flux from the horizon to the boundary. And this can give you a more complicated matrix. But when you now compute the resistance of this theory using the gravitational methods, you get the result that resistance is zero at all temperatures. So, okay, that's, after some thought, you realize this is actually a very trivial statement. It simply comes from the following facts, that there's a conserved total momentum. The current itself is not conserved. The density of electric charge is conserved. The current J is not a conserved quantity, but the momentum, which is a component of the energy momentum tensor, is a conserved density. However, these systems have, when you put a finite chemical potential, there's a non-zero cross-correlation between the momentum and the current. So when you set up a current, you also induce a momentum, and that momentum never decays. So the conserved momentum, in fact, drags electric charges, and so the resistance is zero. So to get any resistance, you've got to break translational symmetry, and the simplest way to do that is to couple some space-dependent perturbation to some operator of the conformal field theory. So anyway, when you do this, holography gives you this sort of answer on the temperature dependence of the resistance. And what was realized over the last 5-10 years was that you can understand this answer actually very simply by an old method called the memory function method in condensed matter, which is the way chemists originally described strongly dissipative systems. So if you apply the memory function method to this quantum field theory, you can, in fact, reproduce the answer for the resistance due to breaking translation invariance. So to summarize, the point here is that we already know that gravity and holography know about classical hydrodynamics. So that's been well established over the last few years. But what this type of computation shows, it also knows about quantum corrections, which are beyond hydrodynamics, like what the ones that lead to the temperature dependence of the resistance. Anyway, so with that insight, we can apply these methods to ordinary field theory. So this is the field theory I introduced of a SU2 gauge theory coupled to a Fermi surface. And so what we learn here is that you should really think of this field theory not in terms of quasi-particles. What you have, the way you should think about it is that you have condensed matter physicists, when given a problem to compute a resistance, say, where's the Fermi surface? Let me compute the scattering around the Fermi surface and compute that scattering rate to get a resistivity. But what we learn is that's absolutely the wrong thing to do. What you should assume is that everything relaxes to thermal equilibrium very quickly around the Fermi surface. And what matters is how you relax the momentum. And this can happen very slowly due to other things. And in fact, the point is that the momentum relaxation could be controlled by operators or excitations that don't even carry charge. They don't even have to be fermionic. And in fact, if you take the very simplest operator in this theory, which is at the square of the Higgs field, you'll find a linear resistance. Okay, so let me put up the... So that's the exciting result of a few months ago, to me anyway. So the conclusions. So we've made some quantitative predictions, struck our necks out, in a way, in this extrapolation from high to low frequencies, using operator product expansion quantum Monte Carlo and black brains for something that was not... There was really no other theoretical methods to compute, and we hope experiments will test them. And the lesson from holography away from conformal field theories is that the most important thing to determine transport in non-quasi-particle system is not any incipient quasi-particle relaxation rate, which is the way just essentially every paper in condensed matter approached it, but really think about conservation of momentum and the modes that lose momentum most efficiently invariably turn out to be neutral and bosonic. So exact opposite of what should have been done. And this, we think, are very optimistic, could offer an explanation of some of the experimental trends, but it's certainly too early to claim that. So thank you very much. Yes, Andy there. Yeah, so though Andy's question is, would the neutral bosonic modes show up in heat current? Yes, they certainly would. In fact, they show up almost too well. If you take the simple approximation of a single momentum and relaxation rate, you get an infinite thermal conductivity. So you have to go beyond the very simple approach we've taken so far, put in higher corrections, and we haven't done that yet.
Why is the group, the relevant group, SU2 and not other group?
Why is the group SU2 and not anything else? Well, as I showed you, it is connected in some way to the fact that the locally fluctuating auto parameter is also transformed under spin SU2. And that's, so when you go to a rotating reference frame, that gives you a gauge SU2. So it's kind of the Berry phases of the spin as you move around. But you know, that's the proposal. I mean, I think many of the things I talked about would apply equally to almost any gauge group and so on. It would be, you know, maybe my dream is someday, if any of this works out as real theory of non-Fermi liquids, that we can actually know it's SU2 and not SU3 and what precisely the topological order is. I mean, that's an extremely difficult question. Even for gapped spin liquids, like the very simplest Z2 spin liquid on the Kagome antiferromagnet, which is fully gapped, we're still arguing about what is the gauge group associated to the gapped excitation. So this is going to be much harder than that. Well, let's see. At least we'll see. But we don't know, you know, how to test that, really.
More questions? Okay.